Okay, so this is the last in my talk about complex hyperbolic things. So I'm going to do what I was supposed to do yesterday, and then maybe I will try to do what I'm supposed to do today. And, well, if we don't finish, we don't finish. So let's just remember that we've got A in, and I'm really wanting today to think of SU to start with and not PSU, because I'm going to be classifying and I'm going to be using traces to classify the dynamics of the action of elements of SU of H. And we will just remember that that means that A inverse was H inverse A star H. And at the moment, I don't particularly care which Hermitian form I'm going to use. From time to time, I might specialize into something. And so the question is, how do we classify elements? And the major claim is going to be that we have this three-way split of loxodromic, parabolic, and elliptic, just as we had for the more familiar real hyperbolic geometry. So I'm going to claim, or proposition perhaps. And I think I'm going to credit this to Chen and Greenberg. It possibly is older, but that's a fantastic paper. From, I think, 1974. It aims to give a unified treatment of real, complex, and quaternionic hyperbolic geometry in all dimensions. They don't deal with octonionic, but we've already heard this Pepe referred to Chen Greenberg limit set. That's also in this same paper that we have. A is loxodromic if it's got two fixed points and they're both on the boundary of H. I'm sticking to two dimensions for today. Most of this will work in more generality, but I want to be specific. Great. Thank you very much.
Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you. A is going to be parabolic if it's got exactly one fixed point, and that lies on the boundary of complex hyperbolic space. And A is going to be elliptic if it fixes at least one point inside H2C. And that's all. Maybe including identity. Except, of course, the identity. I get you can, in this definition, the identity becomes elliptic, but we don't really want that to happen. So that's nice because we know and love lots of things from SL2R. Perhaps even we get adventurous and go to SL2C, and the same trichotomy happens here. And so let's see if we can, in a very, very naive and simple-minded way, can generate this classification. And this is the sort of thing that you could give to a first-year undergraduate as an exercise. It's basically nothing more than I would teach in linear algebra. So it's really, really simple. Because, as I say, I'm using linear algebra to do all the hard work for me. So here's a nice lemma. So if lambda is an eigenvalue of A, then so is lambda bar inverse. That looks really, really useful when you're dealing with the sort of standard positive definite unitary matrices. All of your eigenvalues have the form e to the I theta, and all that would be saying is if e to the I theta is an eigenvalue, then so is e to the I theta, which we kind of knew. So the only content in this is when model lambda is different from 1. So we just notice trivial. I think I don't want to speak about quaternions for this, but there is some notion of eigenvalues, and you can do a certain amount of things. I'm really wanting to stick to the complex case, and because I'm going to be dealing with traces, and there's no sensible definition of trace for the. So you work a little bit harder, but the same sort of thing will work. But I'm just going to stick to the complex case today. So let's see if we can prove this lemma, because it's first thing in the morning. Let's kind of see if that coffee has kicked in and see if we can prove this. Well, it's really easy to prove, which is good news. So lambda is an eigenvalue of A. This is what we're assuming. This means that lambda bar is an eigenvalue of A star. Right, A star is the conjugate transpose. The eigenvalues of a matrix and its transpose are the same. So all I would do would be complex conjugating the characteristic polynomial. So lambda bar is an eigenvalue of A star. What do we know? A inverse is conjugate to A star. Right? And if lambda bar is an eigenvalue of A inverse, then lambda bar inverse is an eigenvalue of A. So now, if lambda is an eigenvalue of A with mod lambda strictly bigger than 1, so is lambda bar inverse, which is not equal to lambda. And if we're in the case of 3x3 matrices, so we're just going to assume that n equals 2 here, so we're in SU(2,1). That means that the product of the three eigenvalues has to be equal to 1, because that's the determinant. And so and notice that this has got absolute value 1. So that's immediately told me, if I just have somebody, a single eigenvalue, whose modulus is different from 1, that immediately tells me what the three eigenvalues are. Fantastic. Now let's suppose then that we've still got this same lambda. Let's suppose that V is an eigenvector for lambda, then I immediately claim that V is in V naught. Remember V naught, it was a null vector. So it's on the light cone, if you want to use the relativistic terminology. Well, that's again not so difficult to see, because if I think of VV, A is supposed to preserve this Hermitian form, so that's AV, AV. Well, AV is just lambda V because it's an eigenvector. I know how to take constants outside of here. The first term is linear, I take a lambda out. The second term is conjugate linear, I take a lambda bar out. So I'm going to get mod lambda squared VV. And the only way this can happen is if either mod lambda is equal to 1, which it isn't, or VV is equal to 0. So it's the sort of thing that's quite good to do just after breakfast because it doesn't take much work, but we actually feel like we're achieving something. So a similar argument is going to show that, so we've shown that this has a null eigenvector. Similarly, this one's going to have a null eigenvalue because its absolute value is strictly less than 1. So we've immediately seen that if I have an eigenvalue with modulus bigger than 1, then I have two null eigenvectors. That means two fixed points on the boundary. The dynamics tells me that one of them's attractive and one is repulsive because that's the absolute value of the eigenvalue tells me that, and so I've immediately concluded I'm loxodromic in that definition I've just erased. So A has two null eigenvectors for lambda and lambda bar inverse, one expanding because mod lambda is bigger than 1, or contracting mod lambda bar inverse is less than 1, and so we're loxodromic. If I was in higher dimensions, you might then ask, well, can I have more of these things? Could I have maybe 4 fixed points on the boundary? Well, in fact, you can't, because, and again, if you go through the notes, there's pages and pages of elementary arguments that tell you everything that's going on. But what's happening here is these two eigenvectors span a subspace where H, restricted to this subspace, has signature 1, 1. Again, that's not so difficult to see. And then on the complement of that subspace, or the orthogonal complement, that means that all vectors are positive definite. And so once I've chosen one pair of eigenvectors like this, then all others would have to have unit mod. All other eigenvectors would have to be not on the null cone, and so their absolute value would have to be 1 by that argument down there. Okay, I didn't say that very well, so let me say it again. If I was in higher dimensions and I had a pair of eigenvalues like this, then their corresponding eigenvectors span a subspace where the form's got signature 1, 1. That means that all other eigenvectors would have to be positive definite, so they'd have to have positive norm. If they've got positive norm, VV norm, then the eigenvalue would have to have modulus 1. Okay? Great. So you keep on going like this. I could spend the whole hour and a quarter going through elementary linear algebra to give you this classification. It's very, very similar. So what would happen now is we would restrict ourselves to where all our eigenvalues have got absolute value 1. Then we would go into the diagonalizable and the non-diagonalizable case. In the non-diagonalizable case, there's different possibilities for the Jordan normal form. That would then give me a finer classification of things being parabolic and so on. So I'm going to just cut to the chase and tell you I had those three pieces of classification. There's some slightly finer classification in there as well. So that more or less deals with the whole loxodromic issue. So when I'm parabolic, there are essentially three cases. In fact, technically four cases. So let's do the cases. Well, we could have eigenvalues e to the I theta, e to the I theta, e to the minus 2 I theta. I must have a repeated eigenvalue. And they must have norm 1, so I can always take it to be like this. In which case, the eigenspace corresponding to this eigenvector, it's not diagonalizable, so this has to be one-dimensional. A similar argument shows that the vector has to be null, just using the Jordan normal form. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to get something where, in my Heisenberg picture from yesterday, if this eigenspace, the eigenvector's there, but there's a, well, okay. If it looked like that, where's my colours gone? Over here. Then you would have something that would be a translation upwards together with a rotation around. And so the orbits would look like that. And so we would call this a screw motion or a screw parabolic. A long time ago, Bill and I flirted with the term ellipto-parabolic, but I decided that I preferred screw-parabolic because it's sort of a bit more visual. Of course, if I conjugate this by one of these translations, remember that all of these contact planes are going to tilt, so I could get something that's like a very tilted rotation like that. Okay. Otherwise, I would have eigenvalues, 1, 1, 1, or equivalently, I could have omega, 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 or omega bar, omega bar, omega bar, where omega is e to the 2 pi I over 3, because, of course, all three of these are equivalent, because I have this, I can always multiply by a cube root of unity, because I'm on this threefold cover. But normally we would just say that this is unipotent. And actually, I classified these for you yesterday. These are going to be these Heisenberg translations. So that would be Heisenberg translation. And so that would be by something like tor t. So if tor is non-zero, we call this non-vertical. And if we have 0t, we would call this vertical. This is in the center of the Heisenberg group. And I should be really careful if I'm doing conjugacy classes, then I ought to put plus or minus there, because upward translation is not conjugate to downward translation. In exactly the same way that in SL2R, left translation is not conjugate to right translation unless I introduce orientation reversing, or in this case, anti-holomorphic isometries. Okay. So that gives me a pretty good classification of what's going on here. The final case is where I'm elliptic. So again, we have some subcases. We would say that this is regular elliptic if all the eigenvalues are different. And this is going to fix a unique point in H2C corresponding to the negative eigenvalue to eigenvector in V minus. So given a set of three eigenvalues there, distinct eigenvalues, there are three choices for conjugacy classes, because I could, there are three different possibilities for which one could have its eigenvector in the negative space. That's a slightly subtle point, which I think Bill Goldman misses in his book. So there's a little point there where he's just slightly inaccurate. But it's one moment's thought, you can fix that. But that's just to warn you in case you use those results. So if it's not regular elliptic, well, you could just call it special elliptic, and sometimes that's used. In fact, at least for two complex dimensions, we can call this it's a complex reflection. Either in a point or in a complex line. So complex reflection in a point, that just means that on the entire tangent space, you do the same thing. You have a multiple of the identity, perhaps by a rotation of some sort. Whereas complex reflection in a line, that line is complex line is fixed, and you would rotate around that. These ones are also sometimes called boundary elliptic because they fix a point on the boundary. So here we have a unique fixed point again, but the dynamics are different than the regular elliptic case. And here we have something that fixes a whole complex line's worth of points. Good. Got to go faster. One of the fantastic things about SL2R and SL2C is that that we can determine the conjugacy class, or up to a little bit of a slight ambiguity, we can determine the conjugacy class only using the trace. Of course, we always have the ambiguity of parabolic or identity there. And it's the same thing here. So if A is in SU21, then the characteristic polynomial of A is going to be x cubed minus tor x squared plus tor bar x minus 1. Okay, we know that the trace should be this coefficient and the determinant, which is 1, should be that coefficient. It's not so difficult to determine what this coefficient is, because what is it? It's the sum of the products of pairs of eigenvalues. Because I've only got 3, that would be, it's the sum of the 1 over eigenvalues. But we've already seen that 1 over an eigenvalue means that I could then take the conjugate of perhaps a different one, but among the set of them, that would be preserved. So in fact, we get this value. And we want to know, when does that have a repeated root? Because that's the sort of thing that we would use to classify what's going on. So this has a repeated root when chi A of x and its derivative share a root. Okay, that's kind of the first elementary thing you learn in calculus, I guess. And then there's a great thing that tells me when two polynomials share a root, and that is the resultant of those polynomials. And to cut a long story short, that means, so tor here, I should have said, I didn't tell you there, tor is the trace of A. Yes, there's an ambiguity there because tor was my translation part. There's only a finite number of letters in the world. And if I cut down to the chase, then we have this polynomial, so we have a discriminant or a resultant polynomial. Yeah, okay. This is the resultant. So how do you calculate the resultant? It's an m plus, if you've got two polynomials, p and q of degree m and n, it's an m plus n determinant, where you put the coefficients of your first polynomial in your first entries, fill up with zeros. Next row down, put a zero, do the same thing, fill up with zeros, all the way through until you've got a bunch of zeros, then your coefficients of your first one. Then you start with the coefficients of the second one. You put a whole load of zeros, you shift across. And so in this case, we're going to have a 5 by 5 determinant to calculate. And there's a great theorem that says that those share a common root. In general, for unitary matrices, is Shiv around? No, okay. There's a paper I wrote with Shiv and with Krishnendu where we did the same thing in general. We had some nice formulae that Shiv produced to tell me what's going on. And then we looked at the case of 4 by 4 matrices. So this function here, if I do the calculation, is going to be, I get this f of tor, which is mod tor to the fourth minus 8 real part of tor cubed plus 18 mod tor squared minus 27. It's unfortunately slightly more ugly than the analogous thing for SL2C, which is mod tor squared minus 4. But this is the price you pay. And the locus where that is 0 is a classical curve called a deltoid. Which is a very bad drawing of a deltoid. I need Francois to draw me a deltoid, because he can always draw things much better than me. Let's try again. So I'm going to have 3 points there. So this is 3, this is 3 omega, and this is 3 omega bar. That should be minus 1, so I come down like that. Come down like this. So this is a deltoid. So in the old-fashioned days, people learned all about these special curves. I talked about lemniscates yesterday. And what happens is in here, we're regular elliptic. Out here, we're loxodromic. Here, we would be unipotent. So that's Heisenberg translation or identity, and also there. And also there, because remember I have cube roots of unity. And on there I would either be screw parabolic or boundary elliptic. Or complex reflection. Right, so when we go to the next dimension up, the characteristic polynomial is no longer determined by the trace. It's because it's a fourth order polynomial. The first and last terms of the trace in the conjugate of the trace, the middle term is real. And so now I could draw something in three space where I have the trace down here and the middle term going up there. And that's a beautiful surface called the Holy Grail. Wasn't our name that it's called the Holy Grail. It's something called Chillingworth. And I can attempt to draw the Holy Grail for you. If you want a proper picture, you should look in my paper with Shiv and Krishnendu. But what you get is... Goodness me, I hadn't prepared this, so let's see if I can do this. I might get this off by 90 degrees. You have something that looks like a sort of a curvy tetrahedron. Like that in the middle, and inside that curvy tetrahedron you get all of the elliptic people, so it is going to be bounded in the same way. And then outside here you get something which is like a bowl, but which has been squashed flat at the bottom. So it's like a parabolic type bowl, but then you would squeeze it along the bottom, so you would have these two corners, and here you would have the same thing going the other way. But it's so cunningly designed that it's also a ruled surface. And so there are actually lines that would come down and down and down, and other lines that would come down and down and down like this. Okay, so this is actually a ruled surface, which I can't possibly draw properly. Yeah. And also, so it's that is the surface, and then there are four space curves, which are called the whiskers, which they kind of come up and they sit inside the top bowl here, and inside the bottom bowl there, right? And what happens in this case is inside here you would have elliptic. Inside the top bowl and the bottom bowl, you would have things that were doubly loxodromic. So you would have two pairs of, so this would only work in U22, wouldn't work in U31. So you would have two pairs of loxodromic fixed points, so i.e. only in U22. And out here would be my standard loxodromic, where I have one pair and then one pair of unit modulus things. The things on the whiskers, they're the ones out there, but where both of these loxodromic eigenvalues are the same. So we get a repeated pair of, like, we've got lambda, lambda bar inverse, lambda, lambda bar inverse. And then all of the other things, they're all going to happen in different places like that. Okay. And I can't draw the picture in higher dimensions than that, because that would mean I would have two complex dimensions. And, well, it's a Thursday, so Todd would be able to do it for us. Right, okay. So that's how you do some classification, right? I mean, there's all sorts of other things I can do. If I have a loxodromic element, it's going to have a translation along a vector together with a rotation. I can read this off from the trace. I don't get a nice function like cosh anymore, but I can still do it. There's all sorts of, you know, and so on and so on and so on. All the things that you might hope for from SL2C of using trace to get to determine geometry, or geometry to determine trace, they more or less work in this case. But what I wanted to do, I want to now switch gear. This was the end of yesterday's talk by now. So the beginning of today's talk is I wanted to talk about an analog of these volumes of representations, and to see how you might represent surface groups inside PU21. So are there any questions about these traces and eigenvalues and eigenvectors before we move? Fantastic. It's all so confusing that nobody can formulate a question. So I would normally call a surface sigma, but in the honored tradition of this conference, S is now going to be a surface of genus G with P punctures. So it's finite type Riemann surface, and I'm going to assume that chi is negative. So, okay. I, which is 2 minus 2g minus p is negative. I'm going to let pi 1 be pi 1 of S, the fundamental group. And I'm going to be interested in representations of rho from pi 1 into SU 2 1. The ones I'm going to be particularly interested in, so I'm going to look at all representations, but then I'm going to look at what I would think of as interesting representations. And so rho is called complex hyperbolic quasi-Fuchsian. If rho is discrete, faithful, geometrically finite, I'll tell you what some of the, I'll give references to some of these words in a moment, and type preserving, that just means that loops that are homotopic to boundary components are represented by parabolic elements, and everything else other than the identity is represented by loxodromic elements. Right. Peripheral loops, parabolic. When I say loop, I should mean homotopy class of loops, because I'm dealing with the fundamental group, and I possibly also want to think of base points, but I'm just going to call them loops. And otherwise, loxodromic. Let's just briefly talk about what geometrically finite is. The classical definition for geometrically finite is that there exists a finite, no, is that all Dirichlet polyhedra should have finitely many sides, or perhaps all fundamental polyhedra should have finitely many sides. There are then four other equivalent definitions, and there's a beautiful pair of papers by Brian Bowditch where he first deals with the constant curvature case and then the variable curvature case, and there are five equivalent definitions of geometrically finite. Except in the variable curvature case number 3, which is finite-sided fundamental polyhedra, doesn't work. In fact, in higher real hyperbolic dimensions, I guess that doesn't work either. And so, actually, there are four equivalent definitions. And maybe, in the spirit of this conference, the one that you could think about, because Pepe's been telling us all about limit set, so I'm now going to think of Chen-Greenberg limit set, is that every point of the Chen-Greenberg limit set is either a conical limit point or a bounded parabolic fixed point. Now, a conical limit point means that when all of these orbits accumulate, they're going to accumulate in a cone. And of course, cone now is going to have to be some sort of paraboloid because of the geometry here, but there's something that we can think of as a cone. And bounded parabolic fixed point means that either it's got full rank or we can we can just put neighborhoods of the domain of discontinuity in a suitable way around it. I'm not going to go into that. So geometrically finite is just, you can think of it as nice. Good. So now I want to think about how I might start to construct such representations. Well, the limit set could be a wild knot.
Oh, okay. Well, in
your case, how is that? Yeah, which is exactly the things that we were talking about in the problem session a couple of days ago. So I don't think I would like to call it a wild knot, a Jordan curve. Although you can, you can map the circle into it in a sort of a sensible way, but. Okay, so how might I construct such representations? Well, my philosophy, which I think you're hopefully getting to grips with now, is whenever I think of a problem like this, I think, what would I do in the case of SL2R and SL2C? If I want to construct a representation of a surface group into SL2C, the easiest place to start is to put it into SL2R and then embed SL2R into SL2C in the obvious way. So that's good, we can do that. Because what that would be really saying is I've got a copy of the totally geodesic copy of the hyperbolic plane, and my representation is going to preserve that. Okay, well, we can do that. We have two different sorts of totally geodesic copies of the hyperbolic plane, either complex lines or Lagrangian totally real planes. So if rho is Fuchsian, preserving a complex line, we're very imaginative with our names. We say it's C Fuchsian. And if rho is Fuchsian preserving a Lagrangian plane, we say that it's R Fuchsian. Another way to say this is that up to conjugation, C Fuchsian means that we would have rho going from pi 1 into, well, we've got u 1 1, which is the same as SL 2 r. And I want to sit this inside su 2 1. So how do I do this? Well, I can think of having, here's my SU21, think of the ball model. I put my U11 piece here, put some zeros there, but I've still got somebody up in that top left-hand corner. So I write this as U1 cross that, and then I take S of the whole lot. So obviously that's isomorphic to U11, because I could just... The first entry is always determined by is the conjugate of the determinant of the second one. And it's R Fuchsian and this is supposed to be a Fuchsian representation, right? We're not going to deal with these non-maximal volume representations, right? Pi 1 into SO21 sitting inside SU21. So in the first case, this one would preserve the complex line. Pre- preserve z1 equals 0. So if my picture is here, there's my z1 axis, there's my z or z2 axis, maybe up here, then it's going to preserve this complex line. So we're going to have some sort of fundamental domain in here. And then I'm also going to be allowed to rotate around that complex line because I've got an extra complex dimension. And so, in fact, this is going to be abelian representations cross Fuchsian representations. And the second case, this is going to preserve R2 intersect H2C, which again looks like a disk, but it's a different sort of disk. Good. Right. I want to now define an invariant of this representation, which is going to be very similar to the volume of the representation that we've already seen. And this is going to be the Toledo invariant. And guess what? Toledo invariant is also called Tor. So we've now had three different Tors. So you should really shoot the speaker, right? But this one's Tor of rho. So hopefully it's not going to get confused with Tor of an element or Tor the translation length. I'm going to give you two ways to define this. Let's do the first way, which is the proper way, and then I'll tell you how to think about it. And they're both of them going to be related very closely to what Bertrand was saying. I have, on complex hyperbolic space, a Kähler form. And that's, so, Kähler form is you take your metric and you plug in the J operator, which is the square root of minus one in the second, and then that's going to give you your Kähler form, which I again is going to call omega. This is nothing to do with the cube root of unity. And I'm going to take S down here, which is my surface, and here is its universal cover. I want to take a map here, which is F into H2C, which is going to be a rho equivariant immersion, I guess, of the universal cover into there. So, F is supposed to be rho equivariant. So let's remind ourselves what that means. It means that if I've got alpha in pi 1, then if I take x and x in S tilde, if I first apply alpha to x and then apply rho, now apply f of f to that, it should be the same as first applying f to x and then applying rho to alpha. Okay? And we saw over the last couple of days about how we might construct rho equivariant things in the real hyperbolic setting, and you can do a similar thing in this case. So how do I define my Toledo invariant? I take my Kähler form on complex hyperbolic space. I pull it back under the equivariant map F. I integrate over my surface S. I always like to divide by 2 pi for good luck. And then that is going to be my Toledo invariant of F. Okay? So it's very much like the definition of the volume that we saw before, except I'm using the Kähler form rather than the hyperbolic metric. So properties of Tor. Tor varies continuously with rho in the obvious topology on the representation space, which you could think of as being continuously varying all the matrix entries if you want to be very low tech. It's independent of my equivariant map F. It lies in the interval from the Euler characteristic to the minus the Euler characteristic. Notice I'm not writing 2 minus 2g because I'm possibly thinking about punctures. Sorry, I'm going to tell you what the different cases in just a second. So, okay. So, Seefuchsian, if and only if mod tor is minus chi. R-Fuchsian implies that Tor is equal to 0. And now we're going to start to get into the different cases, whether we have punctures or whether we don't. Yes? Yeah?
On the right side, is that alpha or rho? Do you have
rho? This is supposed to be an alpha in here. It's just that my alpha kind of sank and then. Yeah. So I mean, over here I've got a Kähler form, so I'm pulling it back under here, and then I've got a fundamental domain in my universal cover, or because it's equivariant, I could just integrate over my surface down here. For exactly the same reason that in the case we've been talking about before, I guess that you could have non-trivial things with volume zero. Can you have non? Yeah, exactly. If you just hold on to that question, actually, yeah, I haven't told you the second way to think about this. So we'll just hold the properties for a moment. The second way to think about it is the following. And again, this is very much like what we've seen. I'm going to take my surface, possibly with punctures, and I'm going to triangulate it. And let's just see what happens to a given triangle. So let's call these points P1, P2, and P3. And when I'm in my complex hyperbolic space, let's just suppose that P1 appears here and P2 appears there. And this is the complex line spanned by those two. Now, some P3 is somewhere up there. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the orthogonal projection of P3 down into this complex line. That gives me a Poincaré triangle. So this is pi 1, 2 of P3. Gives me a triangle. I know what its Poincaré area is. The Bergman metric on this complex line is the same as the Poincaré metric. And so I take its Poincaré area, signed, because I want to make sure I'm going around consistently in the same way. So we take the signed Poincaré area. And then I sum this up over all triangles in my triangulation. And I guess because I've also got this area business, because I want to therefore still divide by 2 pi, and I'm going to get my Toledo invariant. So 1 over 2 pi times the sum of all the areas of the projected triangles gives me the Toledo invariant. And again, it's very much like what we've seen about these triangles. Yes? It's this unique line spanned by P1 and P2. I mean, you then have to check that if I took the line spanned by P2 and P3 and projected onto there, I get the same thing. So there are many things to check if you use this directly. The way I like to think about this is the Kähler form, or rather the complex structure, which is the Kähler form is trying to measure, is something like sunlight coming down on a nice sunny day like we have outside here. And I have my surface sitting somewhere in my space, and the sunlight comes down and I get a shadow downstairs. And if my surface is exactly lined up with respect to the complex structure, then the area of my shadow is the same as the area of my surface. If it's tilted like that, its area is going to be zero. And I could also get zero by, this is what I was going to do, this is my clever trick, is if I were to triangulate it with triangles like that, so that all my positive area and my negative area cancelled out. Right, so that's not lined up like that, but I would get lots of positive triangles and negative triangles all cancelling. So, because I've got an orientation on here, and I've got an orientation down here, and if this point ends up on the wrong side of that line, I would say I get a negative one, because if I go around my triangle, it should always have been P1, P2, P3. If I get P1, P2, P3, I get positive. P1, P3, P2, I get negative. Yeah? If it lands exactly on this line, I get a degenerate triangle, and the area is zero. And that's exactly what's going to happen in the R-Fuchsian case. So perhaps I just draw another picture there. In the R-Fuchsian case, then I'm going to get all three points are going to lie on the same line. And so I get area zero. This is R-Fuchsian. And in the C-Fuchsian case, it's going to all lie in the same line anyway. And so I get the full area of the triangle. Good. So this is how you should define the Toledo invariant, and that's how you should think about it, at least if you are a visual thinker like me. So now we split between the cases where we have punctures and where we do not have punctures. So assume P equals zero, i.e. S is closed without boundary. And my representation is going to SU21. Then my Toledo invariant is an even integer. Just like it's not quite what we've been seeing there because you were allowed all integers for your volume. Here we have an even integer. If I, on the other hand, I went to PU21, then it would be two-thirds of an integer. But I don't want to think about that case. So we've learned lots of things. Let's put them together in something which is called the Goldman-Toledo rigidity theorem. So we're going to suppose that P equals zero and that rho is C-Fuchsian, or rho naught is C-Fuchsian. And we're going to say that rho is a nearby representation. In other words, something I can continuously deform rho naught into rho inside my representation variety. So let's think about what this means. Rho naught C-Fuchsian. So the Toledo invariant is plus or minus the Euler characteristic. P is equal to zero, so the Toledo invariant has to be an even integer, and it's a continuous function on my representation variety. So as I continuously deform rho naught, I get a new Toledo invariant, which also must be minus the Euler characteristic because it's a continuous integer-valued function on the representation variety. Toledo invariant of rho is plus or minus the Euler characteristic, and so that means that rho is also C-Fuchsian. So if we want to develop a theory of quasi-conformal Fuchsian representations, it looks like we've got off to a very bad start. Because the classical thing is you take a Fuchsian representation and you wiggle it a little bit and then you get something new. Unfortunately, we've discovered that we can't get anything new. So that's either good news or bad news. But the rest of the news is that after that, things change. So let's just suppose that P is equal to zero still, and rho naught is now R-Fuchsian. So let's just remind ourselves we've got a whole copy of Teichmuller space here, which is going to be 6G minus 6 dimensional. My representation space is going to be 2G minus 2 times the dimension of the group. So that's going to be 16G minus 16 dimensional. And so my Teichmuller space is cutting out a really quite a low dimensional subspace of my representation variety near that point. So the theorem is that there exists an open neighborhood of CHQF representations about rho naught. And I know three completely and utterly different proofs of this fact. And I think that any mathematical fact that where you have three different proofs or three different approaches, that actually shows that something is interesting is happening. The I think the historical order is probably that Gisha proved, in fact, that the space of CHQF representations is open. And that's what he's doing there is he's comparing the Bergman metric on the surface with the word metric and as a hyperbolic group. And so he's looking at things there. Okay, so this is actually a special case of a very general result. This would be Gisha. So this is via, let's just say, Gromov hyperbolic, it's a sort of geometric group theory. Don't really want to be more specific than that. I think secondly, in historical order, but at about the same time as this, it's a result of me and Plattis. And we really built fundamental domains. So what we did was we've got an R Fuchsian group. So this is a Lagrangian plane, and we have some fundamental domain in there. If I look at the pre-image under orthogonal projection, I'm going to get a sort of a tube over that, which is fibered by other Lagrangian planes. And then we show that if I wiggle my representation sufficiently small neighborhood, then this same picture persists. So it's just so this is really using the complex hyperbolic geometry. And the third proof is due to Loftin and McIntosh. And that uses cubic differentials. And I could just basically say analysis. And what they do actually is something even more beautiful. We know we had our row equivariant embedding of the universal cover. What they're able to do is they're able to produce a row equivariant Lagrangian minimal surface inside there. So I know this is not the way they do it, not the way they tell me I should think about it, but I still think about it as if I think of my limit set as being a wiggly, actually in this case it is going to be a Jordan curve, a fractal Jordan curve, then they're somehow solving Dirichlet problem to get a Lagrangian minimal surface, whose boundary is that, actually, which is also equivariant. So they're sort of thinking of dipping their limit set in soap film and then seeing what happens. Yeah? Yes. No. Well, the connection is, well, I think, yes, but only a very indirect one. That we're dealing with cubic differentials because, it's the next. It's the next dimension up. So I think there's the cubic differentials is because we're dealing with 3x3 objects, I think, and then the reason why that thing was triangular was because I was dealing with 3x3 matrices. But it's the right, so that there's a beginning, and then subsequently Loftin has a paper with a couple of other people who I forget who they are, where he's developing this theory further. So one of the things that we're really missing in this complex hyperbolic quasi-Fuchsian is a good analysis treatment, because it was Alfors and Baer's really got the classical theory going using analysis. So they're solving a particular differential equation, and one of the things that comes out of this solution is that they produce a Lagrangian minimal surface. Yeah.
Can you think of these deformations as painting along some laminations, like the Mickey Mouse example, or something like that, or
Right, okay. Can I quickly finish my story, and then I'm going to treat this. Can you hold this over to the questions? Because I've got about 2 minutes, and if I do that, then I'm going to go over time. So what happens when P is not equal to zero? Well, in this case, my Toledo invariant does not have to be an integer. This is exactly why I was asking this question yesterday about what happened when you were having domination with these punctured surfaces, and you said, well, we get cone angles. We no longer have an integer invariant, but what happens is, remember these screw motions, my cusps get represented by screw motions, and this angle of screw together with the Toledo invariant has to be constant. So when I change my Toledo invariant, this angle somehow picks up the difference. But this is a result of Nikolai Guzevsky and me, is that there exists a continuous path of CHQF representations interpolating between R Fuchsian and C Fuchsian. So this Goldman-Toledo rigidity theorem fails, and so actually I don't just have an isolated component of C Fuchsian things, I can go all of the way down to the R Fuchsian things. And perhaps to end with a little story about this. In 2012, I was at a conference, Pepe was there as well, Ravi was there in Almora in India, and we had a question session like we had yesterday, except we were having it out on the terrace because it was the only place that was warm enough. And Ravi was asking me about this construction and how we did this. And at one point, I was using a theorem of somebody called Millington. And all I knew was this person was called M.H. Millington. And so I said, he. And Ravi said, no, Millington was a she. Okay, that's fine. I learned something that day. I then went back and I looked her up on the web. And it turned out that she was a student in Durham in the early 60s. And she got the best exam mark of any student over a long period of time, which was, in those days you could get as many, it wasn't just limited to 100%, you could just do as many questions as you like and you would get the mark for that. And her mark was double the mark of any other student. And unfortunately she died very young, she wrote 2 papers, so I learned about a very, very good student at my own university by traveling halfway around the world and listening to Ravi. So I still have a lot to learn. Okay, that's all I'm going to talk about now. So that's it.